I stopped watching the news on the internet or anywhere several days ago. I decided it was time. Usually I do this prior to there being some event that I don't want to see. And when the various troubles have happened in the past, I haven't been watching or paying any attention. So it's kind of like a little premonition that maybe I should just tune out the news. It would be better that way. It seems like there's been an uptick in the intensity. I can't recall ever being so nervous about a day as September 22nd. There seems to be something quite jittery about this day. Like there's going to be some bad news. Hopefully not, because the last thing we need is bad news right now. Inquiry is best done when the times are stable, calm, quiet, and no troubles. Nevertheless, whatever comes, come what may, we are going to continue to give this message of real hope to the world, real true hope. The non-dual message may seem paradoxical, and yet you can feel that there is hope. There is a way to get free of misery and suffering, all of that misery and suffering, all the suffering, every type of suffering you can possibly ever imagine. There is a way to get free of it. And that should come as good news. Come what may in this world, there is a way to get free of suffering. There's a way to get free of trauma. And yet it's not a way that belief will explain to you properly. It cannot be believed. Belief is not the way at all. There's something beyond belief, which I call the divine reason. And that will show you the way, whereas belief will just say, ah, I can't believe that. That's unbelievable. So come what may in this world, whatever agitation arises, we need to get past that and focus back in on how to get free of all trauma, all loss. And that way is not as difficult as we may think. In fact, it's seeing the simplicity of it, which is the spiritual path. The spiritual path is simply to see the simplicity of the way to be free of suffering. Because we believe in belief. Belief believes it's impossible. And yet, because we insist, we want it, belief tells us, well, it's just very difficult. But ultimately, belief believes it's impossible. It does not take our spiritual path seriously at all. Belief does not. But there's something within us that does take it seriously and knows that there is a way. And we have been focusing on that way here in all these videos. And we're reaching a point now where it's likely that the troubles in the world are going to escalate. In August, I pointed out that August was a moving time, that you had to get your direction set because the train is going to start moving. And now September is that time when events begin to get going, and they certainly have. October, we need to be secure in our clarification. We need to rest in that, be very secure. Very safe, secure, calm, peaceful, and be reconciled to our decisions about what our destiny, what destiny we want to have. That's coming in October, and we're almost there. What are we like, you know, just over a week away from October? So it is absolutely essential that we continue with satsang, inquiry, clarification, simplicity, choosing a new idea, recognition. Now, the I am presence of Isness presented by unconditional love, experienced as unconditional love, is right there waiting for us. It's never suffered any indignities whatsoever. This entire dream about the suffering of the self is simply a dream. Nothing has happened to what we are, to our true identity, nothing at all. And we simply need to accept this fact. The important key concept to know is that what we are, the isness, doesn't require any realization from anything. It's not resting on a foundation of realization from somewhere. Isness is from the very beginning and always is. Everything, all is what it is. So what need is there of realization of this from something? Where could that realization come from? Of what use is it? It's of no use whatsoever. There's no need for any realization of isness, only to experience it. But that's not a realization coming from somewhere. It is simply abiding in that isness. The self is not realized. The self doesn't need enlightenment. What need does the self have of realization? Does the self need realization? Does the I am, presence of isness, need self-realization? Does it need to realize itself? Does it need to be realized? No, it doesn't need to be realized. So the most powerful teaching is that the self doesn't need to be realized. We've all gone for so long thinking the self needs to be realized. We need to realize the self. Who is this we that needs to realize the self? Is there really a need for the self to be realized? You see, that is the question. The answer is no. The self has no need to be realized. It is inherently, fully is what it is already. So it already is what it is. Of what need does it need realization of what it is? It doesn't. It's the belief that it does that prevents us from realizing that it doesn't need it. And we can simply drop then all efforts in that direction. But belief keeps thinking that it needs something, that it rests on some other foundation other than isness, other than what it is. No, everything rests on the foundation of what it is. And you see, these essential teachings are true no matter what happens in the world, no matter what traumas are taking place in the world, no matter what catastrophes, cataclysms, tsunamis, earthquakes, you name it, no matter what happens in this world, this essential teaching remains the same, is untouched. This absolute teaching is always true. Truth is always true. Trauma never touches truth. And there's no need. Truth doesn't need any realization. Therefore, we're free to drop all our efforts, all our thinking, all our efforts, all our struggles, to drop the entire complex of any search whatsoever. That the isness isn't lost. Where could it go? So it's not lost. It doesn't need to be found. What could possibly find it? Is it lost unto itself? No, it's not. All of these beliefs we have are make-believe, made-up, make-believe scenario, hypothetical scenario, scenario of plausibility. The self doesn't need to be discovered or found or anything like that. Those beliefs are what prevent the self from apparently, it makes it seem as if the self is lost to itself, whereas it's not. It's not. It's only an idea we have that it's lost unto itself, that something needs to be done, that there's some reconciliation that needs to take place, there's some enlightenment, some realization, all of that. That's only a belief. That's only plausible plausibility, which is what arises in a belief system. What's important in the days ahead is to be able to continue to focus on satsang and push away the troubles in the world. I've mentioned the September 22nd date because there does seem to be a lot of resonance around this time. Definitely does seem to be that. And something very well could happen. And yet we do have to push that aside, make the effort to push it aside. One of the most powerful contemplations is to insist, to affirm that you will not play in the pool of pity. You will not ask pity for yourself at all. In fact, you will give no one reason to feel any pity for you whatsoever. That you will push all calls to pity aside, which means you yourself will not evoke any pity in anyone. Nor will you feel pity for anyone. Pity is like saying, look how terrible my situation is. Can you not have pity on me and get a little better yourself? It's like saying, look how sad I am. Can you not have pity on me and act happy? You know, I've tried to use this. This is like one of the worst traps there is you try to get others to be happier by you yourself appealing to them through pity. Say, look how wretched I am. Can you not at least show me something that is wonderful? You know, trying to do that. Well, that's let's drop that entirely now. Instead, let's say, look, I'm not suffering trauma in the slightest bit. I'm not suffering anything in the slightest bit. Suffering has vanished for me. And all of you who are still suffering, look, here there is a way. Here's the proof there is a way. That takes pity out of the equation, doesn't it? That is the way that works, is to show everyone there is a way. That works on motivation, a level of motivation. No matter how bad the situation is for anyone, they see that and they will say, aha, there is a way. I can get free of my suffering. I know it. And that turns the tables on suffering. Says, you know what, suffering? You don't need to have pity on me. I'm going to be free of you. I don't want to play that pity game anymore. Another way you can do the contemplation is to say, you know, everybody expects this world to be a very tough thing to deal with, but actually it's not. I want to push all that invitation to pity aside, you know, because saying this world is so tough to deal with, isn't that an invitation to pity? It's an invitation to fail and then hope that others pity your failure and won't fail themselves. But the truth is, the world is not actually difficult unless we fall into that pool of pity, unless we fall into that pit, the pity pit. Let's reject falling into the pity pit. Let's push that aside and say, no, I'm not going to fall in the pity pit. I'm not going to give anybody any reason to feel sorry for me or any pity for me. I'm going to be radiantly free of suffering, no matter what happens. I don't need anyone's pity ever again. And since there's no call for pity, what's the call? The call is people will say, ah, there's something I really want. How do we, it exists. It's there. How do I get it? And they'll stop pitying themselves as well. So this whole pity thing, this pity pit, is really where we're trapped. And if we really concentrate our mind on it, we can find the inner power is right there of a decision not to see yourself in the pity pit. It's a shift of perspective. You can see yourself as one who is not in the pity pit at all. There's a decision. Decide, I'm not going to play the pity game in any way, shape, or form. It's a weird thing to think. Imagine if nobody in the world had any pity for you whatsoever. At first blush, it seems like, whoa, you know, that's a scary thing, because I want people to, you know, pity my circumstances a little bit, and people to feel sorry for me and think, wow, you know, maybe we can give him some help and all that. But imagine if no one had any pity for you at all in the world. That's a very profound contemplation. Just contemplate that around this whole pity pit thing. That literally has the power to push aside the traumas of the world, the tragedies, the catastrophes, all of that. It's more powerful than any of that, because it gets to the, it's more central, it's closer to the root of the situation. You can either be pitied or not pitied. You can either give reason to be pitied or no reason to be pitied. And if you decide to give no reason to be pitied, you will feel invulnerable. You will feel unassailable. Your experience will be of that which cannot be assailed, that which is invulnerable, that which cannot be changed or corrupted. You will literally, that will be your experience. And there's all these excuses now coming in the world for pity. Say, look what happened to me. All this terrible tragedy befell me. And yet we don't have to experience that. We're looking now at ways to push back anything that comes. To push back, and it has to be profound. And it is time in this world now for that profundity to come forward, that which can push back the entire world. Keep it off of us. The world is on top of us. We need to get it off of us. It is absolutely doable. So we need to transit on this day, the 22nd of September. It's a very important day, very significant day. It's around the equinox time, where the days and the nights are, the amount of day, light and darkness is the same. 12 and 12 it should be. We need to now ourselves shift gears and find a higher gear. A gear that is capable of, again, making the world recede from us. That means the world and everything, the entire world, recede. Because what does the world do except generate pity? Generate suffering. That's all that it does, really. It gives to take away. We look at the world and say, oh, ain't that awful? Look at this stuff. Isn't that awful? All this stuff's happening. Isn't it awful? Oh, I pity those poor people, you know. What if there was someone where nothing was bothering them at all? You look at them and say, wow, there's nothing to pity there at all. Wow. What is that experience like? We don't even know what that experience is like. Unless we come upon one who is not suffering at all. and the experience of coming upon such a one is amazing, because we see no reason to pity one at all. And then we realize that we're pitying everybody in the world. Everyone, everything is to be pitied. Oh, you know, this bottomless pit of suffering and death and misery and sickness and loss and trauma. But instead of feeling all that, saying, oh, ain't it awful, I'm really in alignment with all that suffering and I can feel your pain. Instead of saying, I can feel your pain, how about saying, I'm not feeling your pain at all. I'm not feeling any pain. How about that for a turnaround? We take it that compassion means to feel others' pain. But how about we redefine compassion as not feeling anyone's pain? In fact, not feeling any pain at all. Free of pain. If we feel someone else's pain, what does that do? Well, misery loves company. So people will say, okay, they understand my pain. They understand me. They know where I'm coming from. But what good does that do? I guess in some instances you could take steps to try to relieve the pain, but the suffering and the pain of this world go on and on and on in so many ways. But what if one had no pain at all, no suffering, and they say, I don't feel your pain at any level. I don't feel anyone's pain at any level. I don't feel pain at all. I feel only delight and peace and calm. What kind of compassion would that be? Would that not be a higher compassion? Because it is saying to everyone, there is a way to not feel any pain. And I know the way. I can show you the way. I can explain it to you and show you and say, this is the way. That seems like that is a much higher compassion than merely feeling someone's pain. You can feel the pain if you want to. You can feel the pain of everybody and in every last little way, but you can't do that much to get rid of all that pain. People are still suffering. You know, you get a tsunami coming in, you say, oh, I feel your pain, but, you know, they're still going to be suffering. You can do things to ease the pain a little bit, but the suffering is still going to be immense. It's not going to, you know, everyone who's suffering will just still be, you know, just very traumatized. But if there's someone who'd say, I'm not feeling anyone's pain at all. In fact, I don't even feel any pain whatsoever. I feel complete bliss, no matter what happens. And people will look at that and say, wow, my life is full of suffering and trauma, no matter what I do. And yet here is an example of one that is not suffering from any trauma whatsoever. And that seems very, very compelling and interesting to look at. How is that possible? You see, that works on motivation. So, regardless of what happens in the world, and I have a feeling that there's something brewing, something coming, really. We can push it aside. We can distance from it with the goal of not feeling any pain at all under any circumstances. Feeling just the opposite, delight, steady, calm. Wonderful delight. And then, no matter what trauma anyone is feeling, that will be an attention getter. They'll look up and say, hey, what is this? I want that. That is something I want, because I'm in my trauma. My friends are in their traumas. There's trauma all around. And so what we want is there not some, oasis of freedom from trauma? Is there not some oasis somewhere like that? And then if you can present yourself as that, truly, they will see, yeah, there is an oasis. There is somewhere we can go somehow, some way. There can be freedom from trauma. And then that gives them this spirit. Okay? This can-do spirit, this feeling like, yes. And that provides the greatest help and assistance to anybody who's in trauma is the knowledge deep within them that there's a way to get free of all trauma. And then they look at whatever trauma they're in and say, ha, you know what? From this day forward, I'm working to get free of you and all your friends and all your relatives and all your permutations. So you can do whatever you want to me right now, but your time is very short. Your time to traumatize me is coming to an end. And that provides this unbelievable spirit that will not buckle, will bend, but not break. That's the most powerful medicine for any catastrophe, any traumas in the world. The most powerful medicine is to feel that within you, that you know. You say, you know what? I'm going to get free of this. I know I'm going to do it. I know it's possible, and therefore I am going to do it. And everything takes on a different meaning. Everything then becomes an opportunity. Say, oh, trauma, you're traumatizing me. Okay, let me look at you very carefully. Let me see what's going on. Let me take stock of this. Let me figure out, let me see, where is this coming from? Why is it arising? And suddenly everything becomes a teachable moment, a moment of clarification. You see? And suddenly you're on a spiritual path. Instead of being traumatized, you're on a spiritual path. And you look at all this stuff and say, ha, pretty soon none of this will touch me at all. How about that? It puts you in the position of strength to realize that. Gives you real hope. So I have for the last year plus, and before that, actually several years before that, I don't have those videos up anymore, but and for my whole life I have been stressing that there will be times of trouble, and the spiritual path is essential to get through those times of trouble, and the realization that realization isn't needed, that isness, what we are, doesn't need any realization, that is essential, and that will enable us to be completely free of trauma. We won't experience or feel suffering at all. And then that will provide the greatest compassion and help for those who are still choosing the path of trauma, path of trying to become prime creator, path of trying to change reality, path of trying to develop a greater power than the powers of reality, so that that reality can be threatened with destruction unless it changes and makes us prime creator. Those who are still on that trip, that idea, that hypothetical scenario, at least they can get a glimpse and say, you know what, there is a way out of this, you know, nightmare, this awful pit, this pity pit of trauma and suffering. There is a way. So the world needs help big time, very soon. We all need to continue our contemplations, our meditations, our inquiries, our affirmations, our clarifications, our capacity to push the world away from us so it doesn't touch us at all, because the trauma is coming. You can feel it. I certainly feel it. There are the times, they are changing, as Bob Dylan once sang. He's actually coming to Oakland pretty soon. Pretty apropos. The times they are changing is now touring once again. Pretty symbolic right there. So many indications, so many red flags. It's just amazing. You can't ignore all of them. You know, at some point you have to say, you know what? This is it. These are the times. The times are changing. And it is possible to not even be touched by time. It is possible to not even be touched by change. It is possible to have an experience that is unchanging. And if experience is unchanging, what meaning does time have? It doesn't have any meaning. Therefore, it's timeless. It is possible to step into timelessness, meaning having an experience that is steady and unchanging, not fluctuating, not subject to any power that can change it or touch it or alter it in any way. It is very possible. Simply choose a different idea and be wanting to be prime creator, and that does it. So, the best thing to do during these times is to continue with the focus on the root here. Awake from the dream. Awaken from the dream. And whatever else is going around in the world, don't really worry about it. You just say, okay, you know, stuff is happening. We know that. But identifying with it and paying attention to it doesn't help anything. It just feeds into this pity trip. Don't pity the world. Free the world. Free yourself from the world, okay? Don't be an object of pity, and don't pity the world. Free yourself from the world. And then you will be a source of inspiration to the world. That is our goal here. Come what may. And if things happen, you don't have to follow what's going on, really. Because again, the remedy is the same. You're not going to learn anything new by following world events, really. The remedy always remains the same. The ability to focus on something that you feel that you're pushing the world away from you. Literally getting it off of you, getting it off of you. Find that, whatever works for you. Truly feel that way, that you're experiencing is going to be a steady, blissful one. Nothing can affect it. And that you decided, instead of to say, woe is me, it's too hard to be that way in this world, to say, no, it's not too hard. No, woe is me, because I did it. You know, we can either come away from this world saying, you know what, it was too difficult. Or we can say, well, it was difficult, but it wasn't too difficult because I was able to get free. There is this legendary thing about this world where we believe it is simply too difficult to awaken from the dream. It's not true. That's a myth. The world gives us perfect excuses. Don't use the excuses. Just don't use them. Temptation is to say, yeah, it's too difficult. As soon as you do that, boom, it seems too difficult. It's not too difficult. It's only when we want to use an excuse like that. Say, yeah, I want to awaken with a dream, but it's too difficult. We say that, it's because we really want to continue on with the dream. It's really not difficult to awaken. But we're convinced that it is, and so many people have told us it's difficult. It's not difficult. We just believe that it's difficult, and the belief is mistaken. So wherever you are in the world, during these times, always find time to just sit quietly and get in touch with that which puts a smile on your face and pushes the world away. Don't be part of that club of failures that hang out and say, yeah, it was so difficult. I couldn't do it. It was really too difficult. Wow, it's not my fault. It was just so difficult. I wasn't able to do it. That's the worst club of all to be part of. Don't be part of that club, the club of failure, that have all sorts of wonderful excuses, about how tough it was. By doing this, you're waking up. You're waking up. You're dropping excuses. You're dropping the pity. You're not seeing yourself in the pity pit at all. You don't see yourself there anymore. You just believed that you were there. You never were there, actually, but you believed that you were there, and you believed in all this that's difficult and all stuff, but you're not even in the pit at all. Not really. How can what is, isness, experience difficulty being what is? How's that possible? It's not possible. It's only believed plausibly that it's possible, but it's not. Drop all that plausibility. If you accept plausibility at all, then it will seem difficult, because plausibility can make anything out of anything. It can make the simplest step seem to be impossibly difficult. Plausibility can do that, and does do that. So you have to reject plausibility altogether, really, and instead experience what is. Because plausibility says that what is can be turned into something different. And so it can be turned into what isn't. That it isn't what it is anymore. That's plausibility. And that seems very, very difficult to do, right? It's not difficult to awaken from the dream, because isness is already awake, never was asleep. And these kinds of things, this kind of talk doesn't seem to be related to whatever's going on in the world, all the traumas, but in fact, it's the remedy for it, for all of them. Again, we don't have to accept plausibility at all. We can turn away from all plausibility and instead accept what is, and that is not difficult. The turning is not difficult. The decision is one that we procrastinate on and go back and forth on. Plausibility seems to open up a vast universe of possibilities, but it's really simply nothing, nothing at all. A vast universe of nothing. Vast universe of plausibility, what is that? Why get lost in that? And then feel as if it's so difficult to move and find your way in that, when you can simply reject possibility altogether and push it away from the table and say, no, I'm not going to eat that food. Oh, there you go. It's a very, very simple. There's this fear complex that is being felt. There's this dread, this anticipation, this anxiety that says, uh-oh, finally, you know, the long-awaited troubles are about to arrive. And we thought, yeah, come on, we're ready for them. And now we realize, oh, no, we're not ready for them. Nah, you're never ready for that stuff. Never. Never want it to arrive. Never. No. So that's why it's time now to say, okay, let's not put anything to the test. Let's not play the nonchalant hero, like, yeah, I'm ready, bring it on. You know those people that say, come on, bring it on. Do your best, take your best shot. I'm tired of waiting, that kind of stuff. No, we don't really want anything bad to happen. Hopefully nothing bad will happen. Even though the entire universe is simply generating all this nonstop trauma anyway. We don't want any more added on. But we know that this world, various situations happen in this world, we know that. They keep on happening. There's all these perfect storms and various troubles that just keep on happening. And yet all of this is the play of plausibility in the pity pit. Just the play of plausibility. None of this is actually happening. So why don't we decide to dwell in the realm of actuality, where none of this stuff is happening at all? The universe is the play of plausibility. Play of hypotheticalness. Hypotheticality. If that's a word. Hypotheticality. Play of plausibility. And it's no real play at all. It's not difficult to see this from the perspective of actuality. It's not difficult. Only from the perspective of plausibility does it seem difficult to drop plausibility. Because it can be made to seem plausibly difficult, right? That's the problem. That's the problem. It's so hard to deal with the situation, as plausibility can make what is easy seem difficult. And so we keep trying to say, well, I need to make it look easier because it looks real difficult to me. Plausibility will always make it look difficult. It will always seem that you have to do something really traumatic and difficult to get out of plausibility, like eat a ghost pepper. I have a whole container full of peppers here that I've grown, and that and this is the granddaddy of them all. This is a Naga Butchelokia ghost pepper, and it is as hot as it looks. It's as hot as it looks. The way you eat it is you eat it from the tip here, where it's not so hot. So you go, you take a bite here, one third, lower third, then you take a bite of the middle. The first third is exceedingly hot, very hot, but not so bad that you won't take a second bite. So the second bite out of the middle, this part right in here, that's really hot. And that one says, wow, okay, that's enough. Enough is enough. That is too much. Which leads to the third part, the top part here, the top part by the stem, clipped to the stem here, that part contains the seeds and all the coverings of the seeds that protect the seeds. That's where the capsaicin is highest concentration. And that part is just devastatingly hot. Devastatingly hot. So what I have seen in passing out these peppers to many people is that nobody eats the whole pepper. They get to the first part, then they get to the second part, and they say, phew, that's it. You know, that's enough. It's enough. I ate the whole doggone thing. It was very difficult. Very difficult. That last third, the upper third of that pepper, I thought I couldn't do it. No way. Finally, just said, you know what, it's now or never, and if I don't do it, I'm going to feel like, why didn't I do that? And so I said, okay, and chomp, 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 chomp. Oh boy, that was really something. So, the future of this planet is going to be like eating a ghost pepper. Okay, really, it's interesting in that those who have seen the future, at least believe they have seen it, have been fairly consistent saying there's going to be several smaller cataclysms and then a huge total one. And that's exactly what I saw in the dream scenario. There will be several smaller collapses, and then the third one will just be completely massive and total. And that's somewhat analogous to eating a ghost pepper. The future, you eat the bottom third, and it's bad. It's very bad. You eat the middle third, and it's terrible. And then at that point, you say, there's no way in the world I'm going to eat that top third. And when you eat the top third, then you just feel like you are, that's it. You know, you now you did it. And it just knocks you out. Just knocks you out. And you think you're going to die, really. So the future is like that. We're going to have one cataclysm, then a second one, and then the third one is going to be the granddaddy of them all. That's what, you know, many have seen. That's what I saw. And it's interesting that after the second one, people will say, that's enough, forget it, you know, something like that. It's better to not eat the ghost pepper at all. Some people turn it down, you know, I offer it to everybody, and some people turn it down, but most people say they want to try. Most people say, yeah, I love hot peppers, I can eat that. But some people are smart enough, they say, no, forget it, no way. It's better to say, forget it. But most people, they want to know how they're going to respond in a during a catastrophe. They really do. They want to know how they're going to respond. So they take the first bite, and then they realize, wow, that was nasty. And then they may want to know how they respond. It's even worse. And some will take a second bite. That's what I've seen. Some take just one, some take the second bite. And after that, they say, no mas, no more, forget it. You know, I don't want to go through the third bite, the third step of the cataclysm, don't want to do it. I've already gone through it with it internally, so I know what it's going to be like. And it's really awful. It's like eating this whole doggone ghost pepper. Yeah, I'm just showing this to you. I'm not going to eat this one. I've had enough. I've had enough of the ghost pepper. That is for sure. You see, it does bad things to you internally. It's really very, very brutal. There's some other ones in there. So. It's very interesting how everything seems to be coalescing around this idea that there will be, you know, two small troubles and then a third great one. Whether it's geophysical problems or financial problems or war problems or something, there's going to be two minor collapses that seem at the time to be very serious, very bad. But we will recover from those, and people will say, "Ah, it's not that bad. We made it through." And you know, that's the first one, and the second one, another one, and people say, "Whoa, oh, you know, this is horrible." But they'll make it through, and then shortly after that, there will be a third total collapse, and you know, people that say realize, "Hey, we're not making it through this one." So it takes a certain mindset, determination to say, okay, forget it. I'm not going to see how I respond to the traumas. Instead, decide I'm not going to experience any traumas. See, that's two different things, right? Two very different things. Most of the people, they want to see how they're going to respond to the first trauma. Some, they want to see how they respond to the second one. And very few, they want to see how they respond to the third one. And so you can take the ghost pepper test and find out where you're at. You know, if you just say, nah, forget it, I don't want any trauma, and I'm not going to touch it. See, that shows you where you're at. But most people, they say, they're interested. They say, yeah, I want to try it. I say, hey, it's super hot. It's going to be very traumatic for you, believe me. And they still say, okay, I still want to try. I want to, you know, take it in little pieces. And everybody has different ways of doing it, you know, trying to deal with it. So we all have a lot of pride in dealing with trauma. We all have a lot of pride, most of us. We have to drop that pride because the third part of the cataclysms, the third part of the troubles that are coming, you can't really deal with that. That is the truth. It's like when you eat the top part of that ghost pepper, it's a whole different ball game. It's a whole different thing, believe me. is you just realize that you're just going to suffer. You're just there's no remedy for the suffering that you're in. There is no remedy for it. You can drink all the milk you want. It's not going to cure it. It's not going to stop it. You realize, I'm just going to sit here and just suffer. Terrible. There's nothing you can do at that point. Once you eat the top third of that ghost pepper, you've done it. You've jumped the shark. That is true. So, if we have an overview of the future, if we have an overview of the situation, we don't feel quite as traumatized and quite as trapped and all of that. And there's something within us says, you know what? This isn't too big, really, for what we are. It's not too big. Because what we're talking about is bigger than all of this. It's bigger. It's talking about dropping the whole dream, awakening from the whole dream. That's bigger than anything in the dream. So we're not this tiny ant, that's being victimized and should elicit pity from the dream and all this kind of stuff. We're not. We're the dreamer of the dream. We're the one who really has the capacity to end the dream, to awaken from the dream. We are that. We are that. So how can we really feel, intimidated so terribly by the dream? We should feel, not that we're in control of the dream, because that's not the dream we're dreaming. It's not a dream of being in control of the dream. It's a dream of not being in control of the dream. That's what it is. And we can't change the dream, but we can awaken from it. See, that's different. We can awaken from it. We can choose a different dream, a different idea, a dream that's not a dream. A dream in which nothing's happening at all. And so is it really a dream? That's the thing, right? Is it really a dream? Is unconditional love really a dream? Can you really dream of unconditional love? Is that really true? Is it really a dream if there's nothing happening? If everything's totally steady, is it a dream? Ask yourself that question, perhaps. If there's no action at all, is it a dream? You can say it is a dream that isn't a dream. You could say that if you want to. So we may very well be at the point where there's going to be some trauma in the world. Enough so that we really feel it, say, whoa, that's bad, really bad. And if we have the overview and say, that's the first one, They have a saying in scripture, and it's pretty popular, of the two witnesses. I believe the two witnesses refer to these two minor cataclysms or collapses that occur before the total collapse occurs. And so these two witnesses, will come to us in experiencing those two witnesses. We will know then that after them comes the real trouble. The trouble that we don't want, that's for sure. A trouble which will make us feel that we're not in control of the dream at all, which is a very bad thing, because we are in control of our ability to choose a new idea. That's what we're in control of. But the dream makes it feel like we're not in control of the dream at all, and somehow we need to get in control of the dream. That's not true. We simply need to awaken from the dream. That's different than controlling it. Very different. We don't need to control the dream. Not at all. We simply need to awaken from it. Awaken meaning that what we are has never been in the dream, has never suffered at all, and has only always been completely free of any concern or worry or threat or vulnerability, always. That's awakening from the dream, because the dream is a dream of threat, of loss, of vulnerability, and all that. So we're pushing on this door, pushing on the door, pushing on the door. That's what satsang is. It's pushing on this door. It's going around the bend, you know. It's going around the corner and peeking around the corner and saying, hey, the isness is there. Reality is, still is. And that's what we have to do at this time. We have to do it at this time because the world is not going to treat itself very kindly right now. Believe me. It's going to be a bumpy ride. It's going to be a ghost pepper future, really. There are people who I've noticed claim that they can handle any hot peppers. I said, you like hot peppers? And they say, oh, do I like hot peppers? I love hot peppers. I said, really? They say, like, you know, you can eat habanero. Oh, of course, habanero. I love habaneros, you know. And I say, well, I've got one that's really hot, maybe hotter than the habanero. And they say, that's no problem, no problem at all, no problem. Let me have one. And I say, hey, you know, this is no joke. I'm telling you, this one is really nasty. It's worse. And it's going to hit you real hard. And they say, no. No problem. I can handle anything. There are those types, quite a few, who insist that they can handle any trauma. It's not true. Those are the ones who don't eat the top. They get the first bite, maybe the second. Maybe they stop after the first, maybe the second. And after that, no mas, forget it. So, you know, it's often the ones who are most scared, who are the most braggadocio of that, you know, the most macho, saying, nah, I can handle anything. And they get a little taste of it, and they go, oh my God, that's too much. Oh, it's crazy. It's terrible. So, what I did was I knew it was going to be brutal, and I had all the milk and stuff that I needed to at least give me a little relief, the chips and the peanut butter, and I had various things that at least, you know, could help a little bit, and did it in that way, you know, the best way possible. You have to have some way to push the fire back. So being prepared for the future, properly, at least it's going to give you, you know, some ability, you know, to get through it. And most importantly, you can also realize that it's going to be very nasty, and you can decide to not even put it to the test at all. And knowing that many will, knowing they will need help, and they will need to see somebody who is not suffering in any way, is not even concerned about what's going on in the slightest bit. All right, well, happy September 22nd. Hopefully the day is smooth, easy for you, no problems. And it continues on that way into October. Meanwhile, we will continue the intensity of this satsang, of this Christ clarity, to resolve the seeming paradoxes that hold us, you know, enthralled, of thinking that we need to realize something. that realization is needed for the Isness. The Isness is counting on a realization. It is not counting on any realization. Doesn't need any realization. Doesn't need for anything to happen. Okay? Our Isness, the I Am presence of Isness that we are, doesn't need any for anything to happen. Nothing, you see. And so here we are waiting for something good to happen. Meanwhile, we're about ready to get clobbered, you know, by something really traumatic, which is the game of existence. It's the game of this whole traumatic scenario of existence is we keep getting tricked and tricked and tricked and tricked like that way. We keep trying to make good stuff happen, and then along comes the bad stuff. Again, the Isness that we are, the I Am presence of Isness that we are, doesn't need for anything to happen. Nothing. Nothing good, nothing bad, nothing indifferent. Doesn't need anything to happen. Nothing at all. It's not waiting on something to happen to be what it is. It doesn't need anything to happen to remain what it is. Not at all. And so hearing this, it filters in. And has a very, very powerful, subtle effect. So what we are, what is, doesn't need this universe at all. Doesn't need anything for anything to happen. Doesn't need a happening, any happening. To be what it is, to remain what it is. Doesn't need any sort of assist to be what it is and to remain what it is. All right. That's enough because we have to go on from here. All right. Very great. That's it for this video.